Hey. You're Lord of the harvest, and we worship you, we worship you this day. You're Lord of the harvest, and we worship you. Come on, lift your voice and say, you're the Lord of the harvest, and we worship you, we worship you this day. You're the Lord of the harvest, and we worship you, we worship you. Eternal Lord remains the same, as you wait.
chapter 1, verses 15 through 17 and 21 through 26. In those days, Peter stood up among the believers, a group numbering about 120, and said, "Brothers and sisters, the scripture had to be fulfilled in which the Holy Spirit spoke long ago through David concerning Judas, who served as a guide for those who arrested Jesus. He was one of our number and shared in our ministry. Therefore, it is necessary to choose one of the men who have been with us the whole time. The Lord Jesus was living among us, beginning with John's baptism to the time when Jesus was taken up from us. For one of these must become a witness with us of his resurrection." So they nominated two men, Joseph, called Barsabbas, also known as Justice, and Matthias. Then they prayed, "Lord, you know everyone's heart. Show us which of these two men you have chosen to take over his apostolic ministry, which Judas left to go where he belongs." Then they cast lots, and the lots fell to Matthias. So he was added to the 11 apostles.
Scripture tells us in John 15:4, to abide in me and I in you. As the branch is not able to bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, so neither you, unless you abide in me. That is to abide in Christ Jesus, to stay connected to the Father, connected to the Holy Spirit. That's the only way we're gonna win. Stay connected to the vine. Glory to your name, Father.
To be loved is to be loved by you. To be loved is to be loved by you. To be loved is to be loved by you. Tomorrow,
just abide. There's no striving in you. There's no striving, just abiding. There's no striving in you. Sing it again. There's no striving, just abiding. There's no striving in you. There's no striving, just abiding. There's no striving, hey, in you. I wanna be next to you. Woo! I wanna be one with your spirit. Hey! Teach me to abide in you.
Teach us to rest in you, us to rest in you, us to rest in you. Teach us to slow down, slow down. Teach us to rest in you, oh God, you, oh God, you, oh God. You'll restore me, you'll build me up.
This is our prayer. I pray that it'll be imprinted on our souls that today and every day we will seek to hear your voice, seek for your guidance. God, we want you to be a part of what we're, God, what we're doing, Father, but not as it takes precedence over you, because it doesn't. Because what we're doing should be what you're doing. And if we're doing anything opposite of what you're doing, Father, we're not following you. So help us to organize our schedules, organize our lives, change things around, let go of things that we don't need to hold on to, so that we can truly abide, rest, remain in you and in your presence.
What I want to do, I want to hear your voice, oh, Holy Spirit.
according to St. John, the 17th chapter, beginning at the 6th verse. I have revealed you to whom you gave me out of the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have obeyed your word. Now that everything you have given me comes from you, for I gave them the words you gave me and accepted them. They know with certainty that I came from you, and they believe that you sent me. I pray for them. I am not praying for the world, but for those you have given me, for they are yours. All I have is yours, and all you have is mine. And the glory has come to me through them. I will remain in this world no longer, but they are still in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them by the power of your name, the name you gave me, so that they may be one as we are one. While I was with them, I protected them and kept them safe by that name you gave me. None has been lost except the one doomed to destruction, so that scripture would be fulfilled. I am coming to you now, but I say these things while I'm still in the world, so that they may have the full measure of joy within them. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them, for they are not of the world any more than I am of the world. My prayer is not that you take them out of the world, but that you protect them from the evil one. They are not of the world, even as I am not of it. Sanctify them by the truth. Your word is true. As you sent me into the world, I sent them into the world. For them, I sanctify myself, so that they too may truly be sanctified. Amen. Let us pray together. Most good and gracious God, we thank you for this time and this day. Come now and look, help us to look into your word and hide your word in our hearts. I decrease that you might increase. Let the words of my mouth, meditations in my heart, be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and redeemer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I want to talk about for a little while this idea of I am sanctified. With the folks around you, why don't you just come on and say that with me real good. I am sanctified. I want to start with a question. The question is this. Are you Christian or not? For real, I'm really asking you that question. Are you Christian or not? I think that is the heart of our text before us today. Jesus is praying for the disciples, and this is just not an ordinary prayer for ordinary things. This is not a prayer of help them or provide for them or heal them or give them material things. No, this is not even a casual prayer time, and Jesus is just having a good conversation with his dad. Jesus is interceding. He is pleading with the Father on behalf of their souls, their life, their work, their energy, their ministry, their impact, their witness, their being in the world. And Jesus is going to bat for them and asking God not for more stuff, but he is praying for their purpose. I don't want you to brush this aside as something common or like a common prayer, because there's nothing common about what Jesus is praying here. He is begging for his disciples to be all right when he's ready to leave the world, in that his physical presence won't be with them anymore. And he is praying specifically for them that carry the message of God to the church in the future. I think oftentimes in our Western thinking and in our modern day world, believers have never really experienced the real presence of Christ. So honestly, we don't have a real reality of what it's like for Jesus to be like present in the flesh, like with us. I mean, of course we have manifestations of it, but that's not the same. I guess I want you to think of Jesus' presence in terms of his physical manifestation, in terms of like a guidance counselor. Someone who is tangible, who you can talk to on the phone, who you can text and hang out with. Someone you can meet up with for coffee. You get to see them on a regular basis. The role of a guidance counselor is to instruct. It's to show you the way. It's to protect you, if you will. They often help shape your life toward a positive outcome. I remember when I was in high school and in college, I had some counselors or some guidance counselors who simply helped me stay on track academically. They looked out for my grades and they made sure I took the right classes. And every now and again, because I was in band, they would be able to have special powers to make sure I got like special classes. And if I had struggles with teachers, they were able to kind of adjust and put me in the right classes with the right folks. They were there to help shape my life toward a positive outcome. They were present with me to ensure that I was going to graduate on time. Jesus then, in essence, is or has been the guidance counselor for these disciples. He has been teaching them and gathering them. He's been shaping their lives, work, and mentoring them and providing for them on the job training. And now he has been preparing them, and now he's about to kind of leave them. And John gives us this insight into Jesus' petition at the end, and Jesus kind of says these words, sanctify them with the truth. The statement stands out to me because I'm not so sure Christians are Christians anymore. And I often wonder what that word means in our society today. I wonder if there is a standard for Christianity in the world that we live in today. And don't get it twisted. I'm not here to say that I don't understand or have a biblical narrative of what it means to be a Christian. I'm not even here professing that I don't have a sound theological model of what Christianity is. I am saying that our world does not have a real grasp on the reality of what it really means to be a Christian. And I wonder how far our church have moved away from Christianity to where we're at a place where we can't tell who a Christian is and who a Christian is not. And we are sometimes taken aback when we are in conversation with people these days and they reveal this little secret that they are a believer and they go to church and profess faith. We're like, oh, really? You a Christian? You love God? Guess what? Me too. And then y'all have like a little celebratory dance in a little corner somewhere. For real? The problem ain't the celebratory moment. The challenge is my purview is there should have already been something in your radar detection setting up in the spirit that cued you to the fact that there was something different about that person just by mere fact of when they walked in it. I'm reminded that there should have been a cue or something in you that said they got the same Holy Ghost you got. After all, I remember when Mary walked in the room, it was pregnant, Elizabeth's baby leaked. That was a sign that there was some kindred spirits and that the Holy Spirit was moving around them. What's my point? I'm just wondering if we can be real honest and ask a real question and declare whether or not we're Christians. Have we allowed the world to rub off on us so much that we can't even really tell no more? I really want you to consider the question, because this is not an indictment on you personally. This is a reality for all of us spiritually. This is not about conformity. This is about real Christianity. And this is not about pointing fingers or blaming or shaming, but this is about discipleship. This is about an authentic faith-filled journey toward relationship with Jesus Christ. It's my job to ask you tough questions, to rattle your cage, to stir up your gift, to instigate and move you toward choosing Christ and Christ alone. To move you from being passive to active or from stalled to to forward and from potential to purpose. 15 months of online church and 15 months of lack of faith engagement and faith formation and 15 months of isolations and 15 months of closed door and 15 months of trying to figure out church over the last year in a pandemic. And for many of us, we've been had dead faith for 15 years and no faith in casual relationships with God. We all have endured corruption at the highest level of our political, of our last political administration. We've all endured hatred and bigotry and the lack of integrity in our political figures. And we've had it endured racism and shootings and brutality, and our communities have been devastated by a pandemic. Plus, we have rampant the drug problem and the alcohol problem and the gang problem and money problem and relationships problems. Things have intensified in the world, and I often wonder if this intensification has led to the declassification of a Christian. Our text plays on this in the world, but not of the world linguistics. There is imagery of being part of, but not being part in, or being part in, but not being part of. We look the part, but we don't act the part. We talk the part, but we don't think the part. We live the part, but we don't be the part. The real question here is of identity. So who are you? What are we doing? And how do we identify? There's a song by Heather Hadley that says, "I am a Christian." Do you know what that means? It means I'm far from perfect, simply redeemed, bought with the purpose, purchased by love. It's not a form of religion. It's a gift from above. I am not perfect. I am redeemed. And she goes on to say, I am a believer. Do you know what that means? That means I pledge my life, giving everything. I never knew this was meant to be. I am not perfect, but I am and have been redeemed. Here it is, beloved. We are the redeemed of the Lord. We are purchased and set aside by God. That ought to be enough to make you shout right there in your house or wherever you're watching this at. 1 Peter 2 and 9 says this, but you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Here is what I want to say to you today. Number one is this: God chose you. God chose you. I can remember when I was in grade school and I would play those games outside. You know how those children, how kids, we play those games outside. You gotta make two lines and everybody get in their two lines on the basketball court. Oftentimes, they would pick this person. I'm picking Keisha. Oh, give me Jack. Oh, give me Ryan. Oh, give me Lene. And everybody would get picked. Oftentimes, I would be left to be the last person picked for the team. And when I really began to think about it, I kind of really wasn't picked at all. I just kind of was left over. So by virtue of being the last one standing, I guess you had to put me on your team. You know, because they choose all the good people first. Here's what I gotta tell you. God did not pick you last. In fact, you were God's first pick, and before the foundation of the earth, God chose you. From Genesis to Revelation, God has always been picking you and high. You were never an afterthought, but an aforethought in God's mind. And even when we blew it, God still chose you and put an insurance policy in place that even with the loss of life, he was still going to give you life. Look at your neighbor and tell him, I'm sanctified. He is more than the world against me. I need you to hear today that you are sanctified more than just a religious activity, but a spiritual actuality, more than just a casual moment, but a dedicated movement, more than just a churchy theology, but a Christian totality, more than just a catchy cliche, but a dedicated commitment. God chose me not because I'm perfect, but because He loves me. Not only does God choose me, the second thing I see here is that God sets you apart. There's a word here in our text, sanctify. And that word has to do with being set apart for a specific purpose. I've kind of learned in my life as I'm growing that everybody can't do what I can do. I ain't prideful and cocky, but I've come to recognize that God has a specific purpose for each and every person in this world. And even though you can do it, you can't do it the way I can do it, because I've only been ordained to do what I can do and the power that God gives me to do it. But all of us have a specific purpose and have been set aside for God's plan. But not only does the word sanctify include the set apartness, it also encompasses this word that we use called holiness. And holiness is always the process of purity. But I want you to be clear, though. I want to make some announcements, though. Holiness has nothing to do with perfection. And I think this is where the church has become religious instead of relational. Christ was never about what we have made our church systems and infrastructure at times. It seems to me that we strive more to make people act like clones and look and act and walk and be a certain way because we think that is what the picture of holiness is. And sometimes it means to be a saint. I gotta dress like this and I gotta dress like that and I gotta sit like this and I gotta sit like that. No, what is that in the Bible? Because I read that church folks, real folks, had all kinds of issues and all kinds of challenges that they had to deal with. I read that there were murderers and liars and cheaters and prostitutes and pimps and players and hustlers all through scripture. And if God can use Rahab, He sure can use me. And if God can use drunk Noah, He sure can use us. And if God can use a wandering eyes and try to cover it up in a liar named David, He sure can use me. And if He can use Judas to betray Jesus, why in the world do you think He would not be able to do with you? The Bible is filled with imperfect people loving a perfect God. And to think that holiness is about perfection is skewed and religious, and that's not what it's about. God uses messed up people in perfect ways. And I'm so glad to know that my flaws don't disqualify me. I'm so glad to know that my not having it all together does not disqualify me. I'm so glad to know that He still holds my future in His hands. And when I drop the ball, it does not disqualify me. I'm so glad to know that when I make mistakes and get frustrated and get upset, it does not disqualify me from the things that God has for me, because I am set apart. Here it is, beloved, that set apart becomes about the heart. It becomes about a mindset. Bear with me, I heard this concept the other day called the 18-inch rule. There's 18 inches between your heart and your head. And those 18 inches make up the furthest decision between what you do and who you are. And if you can get your head to follow your heart, or your heart to follow your head, then you must be doing something right. And the reality is that align your head and your heart to the will of God concerning your life. And in that process, holiness happens. God, even in my stuff, I'm going to do the best to follow you. God, even in my getting it wrong, I'm going to try to pick myself up and get back in alignment and try to follow you. I'll tell you, a Christian, not by what you say, but by how you live your life. And the last thing, not only are you set apart, and not only does God choose you, but God gives you purpose. The text repeats a few things over and over again. You hear God's word, you hear the idea of truth, you hear protection, you hear the sanctification, and lastly, you hear this idea of purpose. I want you to understand that your set apartness is God's choosing you and choosing us is not arbitrary or subjective. It is purposeful and systemic. God did not just pick you because he had no other options. He picked you with a purpose in mind for your life. Ephesians tells us we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which he prepared for us in advance. We all have purpose assigned to our lives. All of us have work that is specific for each of us to do while we have time to do it. And I don't know, but I don't necessarily believe in this idea of happenstance. I believe God is so meticulous about our lives that everything we go through is him preparing us for our next level. He prepares us, he teaches us, he strengthens us for the journey ahead. And even the bad stuff that I go through, I cannot even give the devil credit, because sometimes it's God processing us through the pain and the hurts and tragedies in our lives, because those things become usable to make us grace-filled in him. And sometimes it's the places I've been hurt that helps me to recognize that if God can bring me through this, why could he not bring me to that? And the last time I was here, God did this, so I got to learn to thank God for doing that. I have learned that my setbacks sometimes are set up for the greatest comebacks in my life. The enemy should have wiped me out when he thought that I was weak. Should have taken my life when I was down. Should have gotten me when my mind was not made up and I was vacillating between two opinions. Should have took me down when I took the pills. Should have kept me when I was sick and in my disease and when I had no faith and I didn't recognize. But now that I know that I have purpose, I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. Though none go with me, still I will follow. The world behind me, the cross in front of me, I still will follow. I got purpose. You got purpose. All of God's children got purpose. Purpose to live. Purpose to be. Purpose to discover, purpose to dream, purpose to laugh, purpose to get out of my bed of despair, purpose to do right, purpose to raise my kids better, purpose to recognize I deserve better, purpose to know that the best is yet to come, and purpose to live a life on purpose. And I'm closing. What's my purpose, Pastor? My purpose is that my life be poured out like a drink offering unto God. My purpose is that my life be used to lift up the name of Jesus in a world that so desperately needs to know that they are loved. My purpose is that when you see me, you see Jesus, and that my actions portrays Jesus, that my thoughts portrays Jesus, that my giving portrays Jesus. I don't want it to be a doubt in anybody's mind that I'm saved, sanctified, Holy Ghost filled, water baptized, blood washed believer in Jesus. I may not be perfect and have all things together, but I am sanctified. I am set apart and I am chosen of God, and my purpose is tied to loving God and doing my best to reflect Him while I still got time to do it. That's all that matters. That's all that's significant and important in your world. It's not trying to have a bigger bank account. It's not trying to stack up on this and get all the material possessions of that. No. My job is to glorify God with everything that I have and be a reflection for my children and my children's children and my neighbors and my coworkers and my friends. And even my frenemies, that God is real. And if He can save me, a sinner like me, He could save you too. That's my prayer for your life. Amen.
To hear your voice all around, your
promised inheritance. Keep us in uniform with them. with all of the saints and with you in the power of your Holy Spirit for the sake of Christ our Savior. Lord, in your mercy, hear and graciously answer our prayers in accordance with your will, dear Father, for the sake of your beloved Son,